All right, it's 7 a.m. here in Switzerland. I have a meeting with the delivery guys in 30 minutes. I don't know how they're gonna transport the thing. It's enormous, but I'm so excited. It's gonna be by far the coolest and most expensive tool in my lab.
Oh, here they are. Damn, it's even bigger than I imagined. We need to go up and down some stairs. I'm not sure how we're gonna manage that. Alright, that's so cool. I didn't know those things existed. I was mentally prepared to break my back with those guys. Yo, it even goes down the stairs. Yep, here is good. I had planned to make an unboxing video, but it turned out the shipping team had already removed most of the boxes to streamline the delivery process. So it went by quickly, just a few screws here and there and some wrapping to remove. After that, I could begin the initial setup, which proved to be quite straightforward. I simply followed the on-screen instructions, and that was it. You might be wondering, what makes this 3D printer so exceptional? Let me elaborate. First, let's ensure you understand what supports are. When you 3D print an object, it's typically done layer by layer. Sometimes, the object being printed contains features known as overhangs. In such cases, the printer would try to print them in the air and it will fall down and mess up your print. So those parts need to be supported, they need support. You typically remove them after printing, but this process generates additional waste and can impact the surface quality of the final print. Currently, I also own two other types of 3D printers. One, the classic fused deposition modeling, FDM for short, printer operates by extruding plastic filaments from a spool. These printers are fast and cost effective, but they often leave visible layer lines in the final print. They're not suitable for producing very strong parts and still require supports for overhangs, as I explained earlier. Two, then there's the stereolithography, for short SLA, printer, which represents a significant upgrade from FDM. However, my main beef with them is the smell of chemicals and the cleaning process. It just doesn't feel very healthy. I've tried some of the cheaper SLA printers, and in my opinion, they're not worth it. The Formlabs printer I have minimizes all these issues. If you value your time and health, I wouldn't use anything else right now. It offers a wide range of resin types to experiment with, providing exceptional printing resolution. Nonetheless, it still requires supports and significant post-processing. Now, let's dive into the marvels of selective laser sintering, for short SLS, 3D printing, as we run a job and examine each step in detail. Essentially, the entire process resembles a massive oven equipped with a laser. It initiates by hitting the entire chamber to just below the melting point of the material we're working with. In this case, it's nylon 12, which is an incredibly strong, durable, and resistant material compared to conventional 3D printing materials. Following that, a precise roller dispenses a thin layer of powder. The laser then enters the scene and its beam melts, or more accurately, sinters the powder, forming a solid layer where the part is supposed to be. This process repeats as each new layer of powder is added. You can see how this goes for each layer, right? What's truly remarkable is that no additional supports are required because the powder, which can be reused, serves as a structural support for the part.
This means that you can 3D print any shape you can imagine. It's crazy.
You can even stack multiple parts on top of one another, making it ideal for production purposes. This type of 3D printing technology isn't entirely brand new. It was actually invented in the mid 80s. However, until very recently, only large corporations could afford it. Back in the day, setting up this kind of system could cost millions of dollars. Now, it's incredibly exciting because we have printers like the Fuse that come at just a fraction of that price and don't compromise on quality. Don't get me wrong, it's still too expensive impressive for the average 3D printing enthusiast, but we're approaching a point where small companies, startups, and universities can easily have one of these in-house, and that's truly remarkable. Acquiring a new tool always involves a significant time commitment and a learning curve, but I've found that it's consistently worthwhile. My goal is to handle as much of my hardware development in-house as possible, allowing me to turn ideas into reality quickly. With this setup, I think I'm set in terms of 3D printing. Of course, there are certain things like PCBs, especially flexible ones, that are too challenging to produce in-house. For such tasks, I rely on services like PCBWay, which is both cost-effective and avoids the need for expensive and potentially hazardous equipment. After your print is finished, you take out the build chamber and place it in a post-processing station called SIFT. This station raises the parts so you can remove the excess powder. I think they call this brick the cake. You try to remove as much powder as possible on top of that hollow platform, and the surplus powder falls below, where a vibrating sift ensures it remains loose and doesn't clump together for reuse. The sift station maintains a negative airflow, sucking in all the airborne powder through those filters, preventing any mess outside the machine. At that stage, the part is ready for use as is. I've discovered that giving it a brief sandblasting shower not only perfects the part but also completely eliminates any powder in difficult to reach areas. Another noteworthy feature of the setup is its ability to reuse the leftover powder, minimizing waste in the printing process. As I demonstrated, the excess powder falls through the sift and you also refill this hole with fresh powder. On the touchscreen, you select your desired refresh rate. For this material, I typically use a mix of 30% new powder and 70% old reused powder. The machine gathers everything into a box, which you then place on the side of the sift to allow it to thoroughly mix the powder. Afterwards, you can simply reintroduce this mixed powder into the printer. It's a remarkably simple process. So, what was my first print? Well, as a one-man show, I often find myself needing to rearrange my tools for recording their activities or simply to create additional workspace. However, the fuse and sift station happened to be the heaviest pieces of equipment I own, and I had no means to move them easily. My inaugural 3D print was an adapter for the wheels I typically use. It worked perfectly for the sift station, but I was quite concerned when it came to the printer itself. I was really stressed that it was bending under the weight of the printer because the wheels are not aligned with the legs. So, I came across these heavy-duty leveling wheels. They cost about $60 each, which might sound crazy, but I had no other option. They're quite impressive though. You can switch them from a fixed position to using the wheels. In a fixed position, you can also finally adjust the height of each leg, which is crucial for proper leveling, something that is required for this printer. Also, you're supposed to clean up the residual powder in the chamber between each print. But I couldn't find an easy way to do that, so I printed this Dyson vacuum adapter, and now it's a breeze. Interestingly, this part showcases another key advantage of SLS printing. You can see the FDM part broke along the layer line, whereas we clearly don't have the same problem with the SLS one. I didn't get this printer just to flaunt it. I actually have a major announcement coming up very soon. There are a lot of hints in the video, but if you can't spot them, just make sure you hit that bell notification and you'll be informed when it's officially revealed. Oh, and I almost forgot something. Peace.